Many of you have seen this video because it's gone quite viral, so my guess is you've seen what happens here, but can you imagine looking out your back window, or back door, and your porch, and you see a bear walking across the ledge? Truly incredible. And then, of course, onto the scene comes the attack dogs to fend off the bear, but probably, obviously, the most incredible part of this video is this moment right here. 17-year-old girl who has the courage to do that, to save her dogs. Amazing, amazing. Now, I'm going to be real honest with you this morning. I do not think that I have the courage of that 17-year-old young lady to go nose to nose with a bear to save my dogs. I like my dogs. I don't know if I like them that much right there. My kids, maybe. My daughter's here. Yes, I would. Definitely my wife. I would for sure go nose to nose with a bear for my wife. You all, you know, we'll see. I don't know. I mean, it depends, you know, who we're talking about. But this is just me being real, being honest with you. Honesty is what we want to talk about today. Honesty can sometimes be a difficult thing. Sometimes we have a hard time being honest with others, and sometimes we have a hard time when others are honest with us. We don't always like to hear those truthful things about ourselves. So I put together a little survey. It's just three questions to find out how honest we all are this morning, okay? So just answer truthfully. Here's question number one. If you have a coworker who has food in their teeth, do you A, tell them, raise your hand if you're that kind of person, like, yeah, I'm gonna tell you, right? B, don't tell them because you're just that kind. How many of you? Be honest, right? Okay, I see a few of you. Or C, don't tell them and go around telling everybody else, right? Some of you probably fall into that category. Question number two, if you have a friend who has forgotten to zip up their zipper, awkward moment, do you A, tell them, all right, probably a lot of the same people, B, don't tell them because I'm not going there, or don't tell them and make zipper jokes all day long, like, I broke the zipper on my pants today, now I'm on the no-fly list, terrible dad joke. All right, number three, if you have a spouse or a roommate or friend or maybe a parent, I don't know, who thinks their cooking is good, but it really isn't, do you tell them, you're just on, you need to go take a master class, like on cooking? Or B, don't tell them and just stuff it down, all right, let me see you, okay. You're probably living in that reality right now. No, don't name any names. Or you do what Raymond Barone did in Everybody Loves Raymond. Maybe you've seen this.
Man, isn't this thing great? I wish they made one of these you could ride.
Here, I made you a meatloaf sandwich.
Oh, thanks.
Mm. Oh. Mostly sunny skies today with brisk easterly winds. Expect a high near 52 degrees. Clear tonight with a low near 41. Tomorrow, more sun.
Well, last week we opened up our Bibles to Isaiah chapter 6. I invite you to do that again today. And in Isaiah chapter 6, which is where we're going to be throughout this whole series, 2020, exploring God's vision for our life, we saw that God is above us and God is all around us. And most importantly, He is different than us. He is a holy God, set apart, perfect in all of His ways. And the angels declared this, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty. Our God is a holy God. Well, this week, we're going to learn that our God is not only a holy God, but our God is an honest God. He loves the truth, and He hates anything that is short of the truth. Therefore, our honest God wants us, his people, to be honest about our sin. Honest not just with one another, but honest about ourselves, and most importantly, honest with him. And we can see some brutal honesty at play in our passage today in Isaiah chapter 6, starting in verse 1. In the year that King Uzziah died. That's a pretty loaded and significant sentence. Austin explored it a little bit last week, but just by way of reminder, King Uzziah is a king who sat on the throne for 52 years. He became king when he was 16 years old. He was a beloved king that people trusted in. Now, he wasn't perfect. It says that he did right in the eyes of the Lord, but there was pride later in his life. But he was nonetheless a king that people honored and revered, and he has passed away. It is a time of great uncertainty and anxiousness in the land. In the midst of that uncertainty, Isaiah says, writes, I saw the Lord, high and exalted, seated on a throne, and the train of his robe filled the temple. We see the authority, the sovereignty of God, that he is high and above us, but not only that, he is all around us, filling this place, the very presence of God among us. Above him were seraphim, angels, each with six wings. With two wings they covered their faces, with two they covered their feet, and with two they were flying. And they were calling to one another, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord Almighty. The whole earth is full of his glory. And at the sound of their voices, they were singing so loud, the doorposts and the thresholds were shaking, and the temple was filled with smoke. And here's Isaiah's response, kind of the focal point of our passage this morning. Woe to me, I cried. I am ruined, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And my eyes have seen the King, the Lord Almighty. Inflection matters when you read this passage, right? Woe to me, I am ruined, I am unclean, my lips are unclean, my words are unclean, and the people that I live among, we are unclean and unholy as well. I can't believe my eyes have seen the Lord, the King Almighty. Then one of the seraphim flew to me with a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. With it he touched my mouth, and he said, See, this has touched your lips, your guilt is taken away, your sin atoned for. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, Whom shall I send, and who will go for us? And I said, Here am I, send me. It is the holy otherness and the perfect purity of God that exposes the unholiness and the unworthiness of Isaiah and the people of Israel. It's kind of like when you wake up in the morning and you put on a shirt and it's in the, you know, dimly lit closet or bedroom, and you think everything's great, ready to start your day, and then you step out the door into the bright sun and you see the stain on your shirt. The brightness of the sun exposes the blemish. The holiness of God exposes the sinfulness of man. And here we see how Isaiah responds to being exposed, to being fully laid bare before the Lord. He responds with raw and real honesty. You can hear it in verse 5. Woe to me, I am ruined, I am unclean, my lips are unclean, I live among a people of unclean lips. I can't believe we are beholding the very presence of God in light of our uncleanliness. There's honesty in those words. We need to be honest with ourselves, and we need to be honest with God. So what does that mean? What does it mean for us to be honest with God and with ourselves about sin? First of all, being honest with God about our sin, it starts with confession. It starts with confession. It starts with us being humble enough to simply name our sin, to acknowledge it, to own it, to not pretend that it doesn't exist or that we didn't do it, but to just flat out say it, to just confess it, right? That's the confession that Isaiah offers. What is he confessing? He's confessing that his words are full of hypocrisy, and the words of the people of Israel are full of hypocrisy. They claim special status as the children of God, yet they're living in disobedience to the very law of God. They are unclean and hypocritical, and so he names it. He confesses it out loud. And so it's true for us, that if we are to fully experience the gospel life, it must start with confession. God, I have sinned against you in these ways. And we name it. We're honest about it. We don't run from it. We don't hide it. We don't try to blame other people, blame our past, blame our circumstances. We get to the heart of the problem, the root of the issue. But so often we fail to do this. So easily we focus on the wrong things, on everything else but the real issue. But we need to recognize that the brokenness of this world that prompts us to long for the peace of heaven is our sin. Our sin, our gossip, our slander, our jealousy, our lust, our addictions, our drunkenness, our unfaithfulness, our anger. Recently, I read the story of an 82-year-old man who had to have his left leg amputated, removed due to medical problems. He went into the hospital to have the surgery, was put to sleep. When he woke up, he realized and discovered that they amputated the wrong leg. They took his right leg instead. Friends, too often we try to fix our problems by cutting away at the wrong things, by focusing on the wrong causes. When we do this, when we're dishonest about our sin, it leads to disequilibrium. And we will find ourselves always treating the symptoms, but never addressing the real issue. And as a result, we will find ourselves disoriented and disillusioned. Can I confess something to you this morning? I'm a big baby. I hate roller coasters. I absolutely hate roller coasters. Anybody with me on this? Can't stand them. You're my people. The rest of you are weird. You love them, I guess. I don't know. It's not the heights. I'm not afraid of heights. I'm not afraid of the mechanics or the speed or any of that. I just get nauseous. Like when I'm on that roller coaster, even looking at a roller coaster kind of makes me sick and I want to throw up before the ride is even over and I feel horrible the rest of the day. I think I first realized this when I was a teenager. Went to an amusement park in my hometown and my friends talked me into getting on a ride called the Gravitron. You ever heard of this before? Here's a picture of the Gravitron. It's like, it's a torture chamber, I'm convinced. A torture chamber, you step inside of it, it's got neon lights and it's very dark inside and you lay on a mat and start spinning around at the speed of light and centrifugal force forces you to go up and down and up and down and it's just absolutely miserable. And when I got off the ride, I was dizzy and disoriented and I had to make my way directly to a trash can to release the cotton candy that had gathered in my intestines, right? Sin turns us upside down and inside out. It confuses us, and it creates within us a distance from God and from one another that God never intended for there to be. And here's the thing, the enemy, who is the father of confusion and lies, he wants to live in that disorientation. He wants us to stay in the Gravitron. He wants us to stay in that place of confusion. He wants us to live there. But when we name our sin, when we just are honest about it, we confess it, when we name it, it no longer has control over our lives. So what sin do you need to name this morning? Being honest with God starts with confession, and it continues with repentance. Repentance. Now, at first, it may seem like the two are the same, confession and repentance, but they're not exactly the same. Confession is an admission of wrong. But repentance is remorse and brokenness for that wrongdoing. It's a genuine brokenness over the pain that our sin has caused the heart of God and the pain that our sin has caused other people, because sin is never individual. It's always communal. It always affects the people around us. Repentance is coming to that place in our life when we realize that we are out of sync with God and with others. By way of analogy, it's like jet lag. I don't know if you've ever experienced extreme jet lag before, but in my travels overseas to Asia, to Japan, to Cambodia, everything's turned upside down, right? Noon becomes midnight, midnight becomes noon. At 6 p.m., you are terribly tired and you just want to go to bed and close your eyes. You can barely keep your eyes open. But then at 2 a.m., 3 o'clock in the morning, you're wide awake, ready to go. Everything's out of balance. Everything's out of sync. Repentance is recognizing that we are not in God's time zone. And it's a deep longing and a deep desire to return to that place where we are in sync with God and in sync with one another, remaining in Him, abiding in Him, and He abiding in us. That's the language Jesus uses in John 15. And Jesus goes on to say that the way that we can know that we're remaining in Him and He in us is twofold. We love one another and we obey His commands. But when we are living in disobedience to His commands, we need to confess that sin and have a longing to return back to Him. We see this illustrated in Acts chapter 2. In Acts 2, we see Peter preaching a gospel message, the first gospel message. And you go back just a little ways, you'll remember Peter's the one who denied Jesus three times before the rooster crows. And when he hears the rooster crow, Matthew says in his gospel that Peter went outside and he wept bitterly. To go outside and to weep bitterly is the sight and sound of repentance. Peter repented of his sins. Jesus restored him after his resurrection. And then in Acts chapter 2, when Peter is full of the Holy Spirit and the opportunity is presented before him, he proclaims the gospel, concluding with these words, "This Jesus, whom you crucified, has been made both Lord and Messiah." When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart. They were broken in their spirit. And they asked a profound question that every one of us should ask at some point in our life. What must we do to be saved, to be rescued, to be healed? The first word out of Peter's mouth, repent and be baptized, every one of you, for the forgiveness of sin. I think about the story of the prodigal son that Jesus tells in Luke 15, this younger son who squanders his father's inheritance on wild living. He wastes all of his money in this party life until he has nothing left, and he's feeding the pigs their food, and he longs for the food that the pigs are eating. And Jesus says in this telling of the story, in that moment, he came to his senses. But he didn't just confess his sin and continue to live in the filth of the pigs. No, he returned back to the Father. He made the long, humbling journey back home. And when he was in the place of his Father, he expressed remorse and brokenness over his actions. "Father, I have sinned against heaven," he said, "and against you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son." Jesus says of this type of repentance in Luke 15, "There will be more rejoicing in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who do not need to repent." I like the way one preacher framed it up and asked in a sermon. He said, "How many people want to bring joy to heaven? Do you know there is something that you can do in this service this morning that would bless the heart of God, that would bring joy to the angels in heaven? There will be more joy in heaven," Jesus says, "over one sinner who repents than over 99 people who are like, I don't know who this is for. 99 people who think they need no repentance." Being honest with God, it starts with confession. "God, I have sinned against you in these ways." But it continues with repentance. "God, I am broken and I desire to return to your ways." To do this, it takes humility. It takes humility, a lowering of ourselves. And the one thing that will keep us, any one of us in this room, the one thing that will keep us from restoring our relationship with the Lord and our relationship with one another is pride. I got his permission to tell the story, but when my son, youngest son Hudson, was like 7 or 8 years old, he was on this soccer team, this rec league soccer team, and that particular season, he's doing pretty well, scoring a lot of goals in all of the games that he played. And there was one game in particular, the team won 2-0, and he scored both of the goals. The game is over, we're walking back to the car, and my son says, "Hey, Dad, we won the game." And I said, "I know, I was there, good job. He said, We won 2-0. And I said, yes, you did. Indeed, you did. And he said, I scored both of the goals. We wouldn't have won if I hadn't scored both of the goals. I was like, okay, now, son, we gotta be careful now. We gotta be careful that we're not prideful. I said, you know what the Bible says? The Bible says that pride comes before the fall. I said, do you understand what that means? And he said, no. So I tripped him, and he fell face down into the dirt. I did not do that. I just want to be clear. He's like, yes, way to be a good dad. I did not trip my son, and that didn't happen. But I did go on to explain to him. I said, what that means is that whenever we're full of pride, our chest is out and our head is up, we want people to see us and notice us and think a certain way about us. But when we do that, we're liable to miss the rocks and the roots that are on the ground, and we might trip and fall. But if we're humble and we will lower ourselves, we will see the rocks and the roots, and we'll be able to walk upon the path that is before us. Being honest with God starts with confession. It continues with repentance. And then lastly, it must always end with us receiving his grace, receiving his forgiveness. Confess, repent, receive his forgiveness. Now, I don't want to get too ahead of myself this morning, because Austin's going to preach next week, and he's going to look at the next part of our passage, which is an incredible portion of this story that unfolds in Isaiah chapter 6, where the sins of Isaiah are atoned for. It is the gospel portion of this passage, the part of the passage that most clearly points to Jesus. But for our purposes today, I just want you to know and to appreciate the incredible promises of God that are in the Bible and that I've experienced in my own life. When we confess our sin, when we repent over that sin, then we get to experience the abundant and ever available grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. He is ready to forgive you, to forgive us. He's ready to release us of the weight and the burden of our sin. Acts chapter 3, verse 19, repent then and turn to God so that your sins may be wiped out and that times of refreshing may come from the Lord. James 5, 16, therefore confess your sins to each other and pray for each other so that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. 1 John chapter 1, if we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. But if we claim we haven't sinned, we make him out to be a liar and his word is not in us. And I love the poetic way that David outlines this process of being fully restored through confession and repentance and the reception of grace and forgiveness in our life. Psalm 32, in fact, if you need to work through this process and you're not sure, you don't have the words to articulate to the Lord the things that you need to confess, then I would encourage you to pray Psalm 32 to the Lord. David writes, blessed is the one whose transgressions are forgiven, whose sins are covered. Blessed is the one whose sin the Lord does not count against them and whose spirit is no deceit. When I kept silent, my bones wasted away through my groaning all day long. For day and night your hand was heavy on me. My strength was sapped as in the heat of summer. But then I acknowledged my sin to you and did not cover up my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. And here's the bottom line. Honesty with God leads to healing. Honesty with God leads to healing. When we are honest with him, he will heal the brokenness caused by our sin. And so the challenge this morning is very simply this, for all of us to practice the discipline of being honest with God. Practice the discipline of being honest with God. Confess, repent, receive. And you do it again and again. And you keep doing it over and over. Confess, repent, and receive. And you don't stop. It's like when your favorite band or singer releases a new song, you put it on repeat and you just listen to the lyrics and to the music over and over and over again. Confess your sin, repent of those sins, and receive his grace. And the more you do that, the more you will be convinced of the goodness and the rightness of his ways, the more you will long to live in obedience to him, and the less you will have to confess. You do it again and again. Confess, repent, receive. I don't know if you've seen this video.
Apples. This one for me. Uh-oh. I gotta clean that. I won't build it. Uh-oh, I built.
Through the eyes of a child, we see ourselves. Friends, if you're tired of trying to clean up the mess of your sin, then I encourage you to stop the cycle of brokenness. And in this moment and in this place and at this time, and again, be honest with God. Confess, repent, receive. Would you say those words with me? Confess, repent, receive. Again, confess, repent, receive. And we want to give you an opportunity to do that as we continue our time of worship. We're going to also give you an opportunity through prayerful reflection and through some silence to confess and repent of your sins and to receive his grace and his forgiveness into your life. Let's stand and sing together.